Lord is spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, by the light of the Holy Spirit, instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit, we may be truly wise and ever rejoice in his consolation. Through Christ our Lord.
Firstly, I want to mention Carolyn has most of the sessions that we've had for the past how long?
Rita, when did I start Bible Aqua? Probably a couple years now.
Yeah.
Okay. I think it's a couple years.
And she wants to know if you would like it sent out.
It's on Facebook and it's on YouTube, so, but they're
really
private unless someone knows how to find them.
I will take it on YouTube.
Okay.
If I can find it that way.
Sure. YouTube would be good.
Okay, the YouTube one, all right. Yeah, and just so you know, a lot of times I was late because of Aqua, and then I got in the habit, sorry. And then I missed a couple, and so, you know, I apologize for if you have to fumble through and figure it out, but...
Well, I remember that my soap opera style.
Well, it's by Dave, so if that helps, yeah.
What is our title for it?
What's it? Did you put a title on, Fred?
What?
Did you put a title on the videos?
Yeah, I can send it to the fellow who sends out the emails.
So Jim would get it?
Yeah.
And we got a job for you, Jim. Thank you.
Okay, good. And that would be helpful to me, actually. You know, 1 year, University, one of my students videoed my entire class, and she sent it to her sister, who was a secretary, and she transcribed it, sent me a hard copy. And that was really helpful.
Wow.
It wasn't against the copyright laws or anything like that? Well, him being the professor.
I don't think there was any danger of that. I would like to... We're starting with the Book of Wisdom today, but I would like you to turn to Ecclesiastes.
Turn.
Chapter 9, verse 1. I'm sorry, chapter 8, verse 15. Verse 14, I'm sorry. Chapter 8, verse 14. Elaine, may I have to go here today? All right. We're starting with Ecclesiastes chapter 8, starting with verse 14, and reading through reading through about 9, 6, or 7, maybe 7, okay? Chapter 8, starting with verse 14.
There is a vanity that takes place on earth, that there are righteous people who are treated according to the conduct of the wicked, and there are wicked people who are treated according to the conduct of the righteous. I said that this also is vanity.
Okay, excuse me. By vanity, he means nothing. Not vanity in the sense of vain, thinking you're great, not connected with pride, but vain as in, it's in vain, it's for nothing. So that's the meaning of vain. Go ahead.
So I commend enjoyment, for there's nothing better for people under the sun than to eat and drink and enjoy themselves. For this will go with them in their toil through the days of life that God gives them under the sun. When I applied my mind to know wisdom and to see the business that is done on earth, how one's eyes see sleep neither day nor night, then I saw all the work of God, that no one can find out what is happening under the sun. However much that they may toil in seeking, they will not find it out, even though those who are wise claim to know, they cannot find it.
Notice, even though the wise claim to know it, they can't find it. Go ahead.
All this I lay to heart, examining it all, how the righteous and the wise and the deeds are in the hand of God. Whether it is love or hate, one does not know.
Notice, whether it's love or hate, you don't know. Go ahead.
Everything that confronts them is vanity, since the same fate comes to all, to the righteous and the wicked, to the good and the evil, to the clean and the unclean, to those who sacrifice and those who do not sacrifice. As are the good, so are the sinners. Those who swear are like those who shun an oath. This is an evil in all that happens under the sun, that the same fate comes to everyone. Moreover, the hearts of all are full of evil. Madness is in their hearts while they live, and after that they go to the dead. But whoever is joined with all the living has hope, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. The living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. They have no more reward, and even the memory of them is lost. Their love and their hate and their envy have already perished. Never again will they have any share in all that happens under the sun. Go eat your bread with enjoyment, and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has long ago approved what you do. Let your garments always be white. Do not let oil be lacking on your head. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love, all the days of your vain life that are given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life, and in your toil at which you toil under the sun. Whatever your hand finds to do, do with your might, for there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol to which you are going.
One more.
Again, I saw that under the sun the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to the intelligent, nor favor to the skillful, but time and chance happen to them all.
Okay, what's the basic idea here? You heard. What is the worm in the rose? The fly in the ointment, that was for us everything that could be good, according to the speaker.
Death?
Death. Death is that which blights everything, good, bad, whatever. This thing that comes to all. A living dog is better than a dead lion.
And if you're a hyena, that dead lion may be. Sorry, it's a new year.
Rosie, we first read in Ecclesiastes,
yes.
And the reason I did this. Okay, who are the two major religious groups that you find in the New Testament, in the Gospels?
Jews and Christians?
Sadducees.
Not Jews and Christians.
Pharisees and Sadducees.
Sadducees and Pharisees. What do you know about the Sadducees?
They do not believe in life after death.
They do not believe in life after death. And what about the Pharisees?
He did.
They do. Ecclesiastes is a good Sadducean book. Do you see why?
No matter what, nothing matters. So.
No matter what, you die.
Yeah.
And so when you're dead, you're dead. That's all there is. So even the good things of earth abided. So what do you do? Eat, drink, and enjoy the life God has given you.
That sounds like today's society.
It also sounds vaguely like the Greek Epicureans. And so, notice, that's where you are. As a Sadducee, you can see why the priests and the Sadducees were priests. I think you can see why the priests were more likely to cooperate with the Greeks who conquered them, because the same fate comes to them, whether they do or don't. And if they don't cooperate, that fate may come sooner than later. Am I making sense here? So when I taught the Book of Wisdom at the university, I always had my students read Ecclesiastes first. In order to give them some sense of, okay, this is Old Testament thinking. There's only one book in the Old Testament. The earliest book in the Old Testament that speaks of life after death is the last chapter of the book of Daniel. That's the first reference we have in our Old Testament. And it was written about 160, somewhere between 162 and 167. So very late. Notice, Dan, I haven't forgotten.
Oh, that's right.
Notice also that when Jesus addresses the Sadducees, he most often quotes from what books? Have you ever noticed this?
Prophets.
Not the prophets.
Ecclesiastes.
Pardon?
This book?
The first five books. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Because these were the only books that the Sadducees acknowledged as that would be the equivalent of our Gospels for them. And they did not accept the prophets. The Sadducees did not. Not as being sacred tradition, yes, but not sacred tradition. So, notice, that's a pretty grim view of life, wouldn't you say?
So, all right. John, why would Ecclesiastes be accepted as being canonical? Because that isn't what we believe, that it's all about carpe diem. There is more to life than now. We are here for the hereafter. So why would it have been accepted? Not that we can't learn from that which is contrary, but for it to have been accepted as canonical.
Well, what about the Book of Job? Which, again,
but he held on to hope in God, that God would not allow him to stay in misery.
That's true, but he still would die.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then that nothing beyond that. I'm going to respond to your question.
Are you?
Okay. What about the first five books of the Bible? Notice, what does Jacob say? Short and evil have been my years? Because I go down to Sheol. I think we don't notice all of those ordinarily because we're thinking from the perspective of Jesus.
But it seems like the whole theme of Ecclesiastes.
The major,
world of night.
That's true.
Eat, drink, and be merry.
There's a lot more to it.
Okay.
There's a lot more to it. But that certainly is a major idea. If it were not so, I would not do that.
Okay.
Have a great day. Okay, now, what is it? One more question. Have you ever read Song of Songs?
Yeah.
Bits and pieces.
Okay. It is quite erotic.
I read a commentary that said it was actually a tavern type song, and it shouldn't have.
It was. It was originally, most scholars acknowledge, a love song celebrating the union of a man and a woman, and it's very explicit. Now,
which book was that?
Song.
I've read them, but I guess I don't remember it being that erotic.
It is.
one of them says, you know, Hosea is the one that reminds me of being erotic.
Yeah. Well, why include these books? You see what I'm getting at now. I'm trying to
put inspired by
Ecclesiastes in a group with others. Why are these in the Bible? Why are they canonical? Because they have something of value to offer. Let me put it like this. Any of you ever studied debate?
Studied what?
Debate. What is the best way for you to prepare to debate someone?
To understand
the opposite point of view better than the person who holds it. And so all of this together is to give us a greater awareness and greater understanding of life and of the different perspectives on life. Now, why did the church use this? Because it's important to recognize that life is not a bed of roses. And there's a great deal of wisdom here. I've pulled out passages for my own purpose.
Now, didn't they say here wisdom is fleeting too?
Wisdom is fleeting because you're going to die. And so, all of these books were not the Book of Wisdom, but all the books that I've mentioned, were regarded as the sacred tradition by the Jews themselves. Why? Because there is wisdom in Ecclesiastes. And notice, to this day, there is no clear sense of what comes after death with Judaism. Notice I said no clear sense. We have images, pictures, but they're not meant to be, what, realistic, if you will? So, Lois?
Mm-hmm.
It was included because it's regarded as wisdom, to be aware. One way you can even put it in tradition, be mindful of your end. Even if you're remembered for a short time, how do you want to be remembered? And so on. You could ask questions of this sort. The book was rewritten or revised. And so the very last statement in Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, verse 13.
end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for that is the whole duty of everyone. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil.
Okay, notice. Okay, fear God and keep his commandments. But does he say that you will live after death? No.
But they did believe that what evil you do will be visited upon your children. Okay,
that is correct. In a number of Old Testament books, you have the idea of the victimizer victimized. In other words, the one who acts in an evil manner will get exactly what he gives. And so, again, the wisdom of it. Okay, any other guy? Damon, did it?
Yeah, I was big. I kind of brought it up when I said, you know, wisdom wasn't followed.
Okay, good enough.
So we've been forgiven of our simple things we have done thus far. Is that going to be rehashed then at Judgment Day?
When we're forgiven. It doesn't mean that it's forgotten. I think somewhere along the way, that was a very bad statement to come along. Forgive and forget. Mm-hmm. Forgive, yes.
Mm-hmm. But you don't forget.
You don't forget. And what's more, if I could put something personal here. Ruth and I had a flight, and then after everything was okay, I would say, "Now, honey, the reason that this happened, remember what happened?" "Well, I don't remember what we were fighting about." So I said, "Well, how can we ever resolve something if you forget our differences, our conflicts?" She said, "But you're supposed to forgive and forget." I said, "If you forget, you can't do anything about it. You'll just repeat it."
I've always heard that one of the people was always right in the area.
So I have not found forgiving and forgetting, the forgetting part, very helpful. But yeah, we can't necessarily forget. And by the way, I think it's people laugh about it, but I think it's quite appropriate to go to reconciliation 2 or 3 times about the same matter, because sometimes you think it's resolved and you're forgiven, and then it boils up and here we go again. Hey, go back again. All right, wisdom, the Book of Wisdom. This is certainly a book that has been a part of our tradition since, I don't know. First of all, what is the Septuagint?
Is that what Jerome?
The 70 or 72 scholars that were brought together in Alexandria, Egypt, and they translated the sacred tradition of the Jews around 250 B.C. Now, by the way, translated into Greek. And that was the Bible. Wait, I shouldn't use that word, because remember, the Jewish Bible was not canonized until between 90 and 100 A.D., after Jesus. But this was the version that was read. There were some others in Greek, but this was the main one. And do you remember where this was translated? Alexandria, Egypt. Alexandria in Egypt was one of the major educational centers. And that is the area within which the Book of Wisdom was written. The Book of Wisdom, or the Wisdom of Solomon, was written about 50 B.C. You can find some saying between 40 and 70, between 75 and 40 of various, but in the Catholic version, it's 50 B.C., and that's, nobody knows exactly, but that's around the time. Almost everybody agrees that it was written.
So, John?
Yes?
Just for clarification, the Latin Vulgate was converted from the Septuagint.
Yes. The Septuagint was the basic text that was used, but it was not the only one. Jerome knew Hebrew, and he read and made some corrections in the Septuagint from the Hebrew. Interesting. Now, Jewish scholars use the Septuagint to correct the Hebrew. So that's been reversed now to some extent. Am I responding then? Okay. This, the oldest manuscripts we have of the Bible, the Vaticanus, Sinaiticus, and so on, contain this book. So all of the oldest manuscripts we have of the Bible, old and new, contain this book.
What do the Dead Sea Scrolls contain then?
It is not in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but notice there aren't many of the canonical books in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Isaiah is a major exception. And any other questions or comments? Okay. It's divided into, this book is divided into three basic sections, chapters 1 through 5, and chapters 6 through 9, and then from 10 to the end, 19. So this book is easy to outline in the sense of its major parts. The first chapters are the reward of justice or righteousness. Do you remember why I say justice or righteousness? Same word. You have one word in both Hebrew and Greek that is understood to be justice. Yeah, and Greek and Hebrew, you can't be just without being righteous, or righteous without being just. Interesting to me how long that idea, that union kept coming together. In Middle English, pete meant, it's the same idea, really. And we got two words, that's a French word, we got two words from that. Pity. So notice, even very late, people saw justice and righteousness as the same thing. You can't have the one without the other. Questions? One more thing I want to mention to you that I think is pretty amazing. Now the book deals with wisdom, but it equates wisdom and logos. Now, what is logos?
The word.
A word.
A word. A In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Logos is the word used. I didn't say this, but I need to say it for sure. Though there are people who think there was a Hebrew version of wisdom, not until somebody translated into Hebrew in modern times. In other words, it was written in Greek. It was written in Greek by a Jew, probably in Alexandria, Egypt, about 50 BC, addressed, seemingly addressed to the rulers of the earth by Solomon. Now remember, this is the kind of thing that was commonplace for centuries. Even I like to use Chaucer and Dante as examples. That they use I, but it's not autobiographical. If the speaker uses I and talks about what I did and where I went and so on, but the term we use, it's a persona. It's not the author. Same thing is true with the Psalms. You know, I did so and so, and the shift in person so often you get in the Psalms. This is a technique. It's not, there would always be a singer or chanter, I, and then it'll say we, and then he'll say you, and then we again. Okay, so notice, that's a technique of, if you will, involving people in Psalms. The use of I is a way of, I'll put it like this. If we speak of ourselves in third person, it sort of distances us from what we're saying. And, of course, it's less personal for all of us then. So, you see what I mean by it's a technique of inviting us into something. Any question? Yes?
I'd like to go back to Word. When John says in the beginning was the Word, didn't you tell us that could be translated thought?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. Now, there are a number of people, number of scholars, Catholic, very much a part of that, who see that connection and think of Jesus as being prefigured in this book. I think you will see why. I think that's probably enough as an introduction, unless you have a question.
Would Jesus have read this book?
Quite possibly, because the reason I say quite possibly, this book is paraphrased or quoted by Luke. It's paraphrased by Paul in the book of Romans. There's a passage in Ephesians and a passage in Hebrews that draws upon this book. So it was not as if this was a book that was unknown. It was a very popular book. So that's the reason I say quite possibly. Interesting that because this book was included with the as a part of the Septuagint. And of course, Septuagint was not all translated to 50 BC. Parts kept being added to it. That's how this got added to it as well. And this is the material. The Septuagint is the Bible of the New Testament writers. Almost, by far the great majority of the quotations in the New Testament come from the Septuagint. Am I responding? Any other?
Was the writer of the Book of Wisdom documenting the oral history of Solomon?
No, not really. Because Solomon, you see, Solomon died about 963 BC. So over 900 years prior. And so, well, notice Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon use the idea as if they are Solomon himself. Then you mentioned the wisdom books. This book, along with Sirach, Ecclesiastes, Song of Songs or Song of Solomon, and Proverbs, are all lumped together as wisdom books. And, okay, the Psalms are in the tradition of whom?
David.
All right. Wisdom is in the tradition of Solomon. So, if it's wisdom, you connect it with Solomon. If it's a psalm and there are psalms, other psalms, you connect it with David. Although there's one group of psalms separate from the one we have called the Psalms of Solomon. Probably none of us has had access to that, but there's a lot of Jewish writings that are regarded as devotional writings. So, am I responding to you?
Right.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Actually, the Songs of Solomon are in this Bible.
They should be at the end where the other one.
The right end where you play the asterisk.
Oh, and they're not in there? Oh, they are there. Yeah, this is the song, not the psalm. You said song.
Songs.
Jewish
songs. Songs, okay. Yeah, no, they're not in any Bible.
Okay.
They're not regarded as canonical, yeah. So not in any Bible. Needless to say, this book is in the Catholic Bible. It's also in the Bible of the Orthodox. And also of the Coptics in Egypt. So, any version of the Bible that is drawn from the early Christian readers and writers is going to contain this book. Why is it not in a Protestant Bible until 1952, Protestants began to put this back into the Protestant version of the Bible, but for most of them, not where they are in the Catholic Bible. Some translations have them between the Old Testament and the New Testament. That's where Luther put them, by the way. Some of them have them at the end of the Old Testament. And yours, I believe, Lois, is at the end. Is that not?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Any other question here?
Is that the same as the Song of Songs?
Song of Songs and Song of Solomon are the same.
Okay. And this one is after Ecclesiastes.
Okay. That play, which one? Song of Songs or?
Song of Songs.
Yeah. Song of Songs or Song of Solomon would be in all the Bibles, Protestant and Catholic.
Okay.
But not the Book of Wisdom. Any other comment or question here? Okay, let's go to late. I'm going to ask you to read through chapter 1, verses 1 through 15.
Love righteousness, you rulers of the earth. Think of the Lord in goodness and seek him with sincerity of heart. Because he is found by those who do not put him to a test and manifests himself to those who do not distrust him. For perverse thoughts separate people from God, and when his power is tested, it exposes the foolish, because wisdom will not enter a deceitful soul or dwell in a body enslaved to sin. For a holy and disciplined spirit will flee from deceit and will leave foolish thoughts behind and will be ashamed at the approach of unrighteousness. For wisdom is a kindly spirit, but will not free blasphemers from the guilt of their words, because God is witness of their inmost feelings and a true observer of their hearts and a hearer of their tongues. Because the Spirit of the Lord has filled the world, and that which holds all things together, knows what is said. Therefore, those who utter unrighteous things will not escape notice. And justice, when it punishes, will not pass them by. For inquiry will be made into the counsels of the ungodly, and a report of their words will come to the Lord to convict them of their lawless deeds. Because a jealous ear hears all things, and the sound of grumbling does not go unheard. Beware then of useless grumbling. And keep your tongue from slander, because no secret word is without result, and a lying mouth destroys the soul. Do not invite death by the error of your life, or bring on destruction by the works of your hands, because God did not make death, and he does not delight in the death of the living. For he created all things so that they might exist. The generative forces of the world are wholesome, and there is no destructive poison in them, and the dominion of Hades is not on earth, for righteousness is immortal.
Okay. Any thoughts that you have as we begin looking at that?
I noticed that her version doesn't have the wisdom of you, but you know, is she more feminine?
Yes. Do you know where the idea that wisdom is always presented as feminine, do you know where that originates?
The Holy Spirit.
No, the Book of Proverbs. Chapter 8 of the Book of Proverbs. You have wisdom and encomium of wisdom, and wisdom in Proverbs is the antithesis of the prostitute. So you have the fallen woman, the prostitute, versus Lady Wisdom. And so that comes on. This book draws upon a lot of the material I mentioned. The New Testament draws upon this book, or this book draws on a lot of the earlier material. Proverbs, definitely. Any other comment here?
I was just going to say, my other comment is it also doesn't include like man or something like that, so it's taken, at least that.
It does do that. That's the translation making it non-gender.
Yeah.
So, did you notice that where hers said justice, yours probably some of them said righteous? Read the very first sentence again.
Love righteousness, you rulers of the earth.
Okay.
Well, justice.
Love justice. See, translator has to decide which he's going to use. It's because of the same word. Okay?
Yes. For she used grumbling. My translation says mothering dogs.
Yeah. You know, I don't know why translators do this. Maybe for clarity. Sometimes an image like that will be explained, and that's what grumbling is. I guess because they think we won't get it.
And we probably wouldn't.
Okay?
Any other comments?
Okay, start again and I'll let you read.
Love righteousness, you rulers of the earth. Think of the God in goodness and seek him with sincerity of heart.
Okay, notice addressed to the rulers or judges of the earth by Solomon. Why would rulers be addressed?
You've got to be authority.
Yeah. And as the ruler goes, so goes the country. That is as old as Greek philosophy, and certainly notice that you find that in the Old Testament with the kings. As the ruler goes the country, so go the people. Okay, continue, please.
Because he is bound by those who do not put him to the test.
All right, what does that remind you of?
Ecclesiastes.
Yeah, it does. And also, what about?
With the Ten Commandments.
Uh-huh. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. The word in Greek for tempt and test are the same word. Did anybody say tempt? Did anybody's translation say tempt? I would doubt it, because this so clearly seems to be test, doesn't it? Do not put your God to the test. Okay. Go ahead, Elaine.
And manifest himself to those who do not distrust him. For perverse thoughts separate people from God.
Okay. Notice, again, you've got one word and two ideas. Counsels is the same word. Start again with that verse, please.
And manifests himself to those who do not distrust him. For perverse thoughts separate great people from God. And when his power is tested, it exposes the foolish.
Ah, so to test God is going to expose you as a fool.
The Nabal.
The Nabal, exactly. Okay, go ahead.
Because wisdom will not enter a deceitful soul.
Okay, I want you to notice. You're going to notice some things in this book that will pass us by because we tend to think, okay, you're a mortal soul, that is what you're concerned with. But remember, a soul in Hebrew thought and Christian thought is a person. A soul in Greek thought tends to be that which is captive by the body. In both cases, immortal. But there's a difference. In Hebrew and Christian thought, you are a soul. In Greek thought, you have a soul. Do you see the difference? Okay. You have a soul. Get it? That's not Christian. You are a soul. With a body. You're a soul with a body. That's Christian and Jewish.
But what happens in death then? When soul is separated from the body.
That's what
Paul says, then we inhabit a new body, a spiritual body. In Jewish thought, and you see this in St. Paul, you can't have a spirit without a body. So, that which is mortal has to put on immortality. Remember, that's Paul's statement.
What about angels?
They are pure spirits, and so have spiritual bodies.
Okay, so they have spiritual
bodies. And then we are going to get a glorified body.
Which is the same thing as a spiritual body.
It is.
Yes. Good. Good.
But we won't be angels.
We won't be angels, no. Interesting, the Septuagint translates it, you are made a little lower than the angels. That's not what the Hebrew says. The Hebrew says you are made a little lower than God.
Because so, we take in God through our life.
We invite God into our lives.
We?
Or we invite, notice, death. Any comment or question here?
But we have to die.
But the death that it's talking about is immortal death.
Okay.
Yes. Not physical death. Good. Thank you.
We take on a spiritual body when we die. Angels have spiritual bodies. Does God have a spiritual body?
Jesus does, so I guess so.
But we think of God as Father, Son, and Spirit.
But one God.
Okay.
So,
Jesus would be his manifestation.
Jesus is the manifestation of God, but not separate from God. So, it gives me the headache.
But he also has a human body, though.
Yeah. Good question. And I have never seen that addressed, to be honest with you. I've never seen that. Have any of you ever? I think that what always seems to be is that since Jesus is God's revelation of himself in the Son, as the Son, that's the best we can know.
Well, yeah, there's always the recurring thing when you see the face of God or you can't see the face of God. Mm-hmm.
You can't see the face of God unless you receive the beatific vision. What is the beatific vision?
Heaven.
When you see God face to face. But until that time, to look upon the face of God is death. Or again, notice, when he turns his face from you, that's rejection. Let his face shine upon you, that's blessing. So again, we're using the mortal and the visible to talk about the immortal and the invisible. Is that... Anybody want to add to that? Okay, best I can do. All right, continue, please.
Because wisdom will not enter a deceitful soul or dwell in a body enslaved to sin.
Okay, does that make sense?
My Bible's just got so many different words that I cannot follow.
That's for sure.
Okay. You're starting?
Four.
Verse.
Four. Chapter 1, verse 4.
Okay. And Sharon, read your first four verses.
Love justice, you who judge the earth. Think of the Lord in goodness. And seek him.
I'm going to interrupt you as we go. And yours says, think of the Lord with?
Elaine? Think of the Lord in goodness.
Okay, so, same, go ahead.
because he is found by those who test him not.
Okay, Ellen?
And seek him with sincerity of heart.
Oh, there's a... Go ahead, Ellen.
And he manifests himself to those who do not disbelieve him.
Okay.
And manifests himself to those who do not distrust him.
Go ahead.
For perverse counsels separate a man from God, and his power put to the proof rebukes the foolhardy.
Okay, Ellen.
For perverse thoughts separate people from God, and when his power is tested, it exposes the foolish.
Sharon?
Because into the soul that plots evil, wisdom enters not, nor dwells she in a body under death of sin.
Elaine?
Four. Because wisdom will not enter a deceitful soul, or dwell in a body enslaved to sin. For a holy and disciplined spirit will flee from deceit.
And yours says almost the same thing.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
So, it different words, but the same idea.
I was looking in the wrong place. I didn't realize we had restarted it. I'm
sorry.
Back here on chapter 2.
Good. Okay. Well, let's pick up there then. Let's see, verse 6. We'll start with that.
For wisdom is a kindly spirit, but will not free blasphemers from the guilt of their words.
What's a blasphemer? What's blasphemy?
Something against God. Yeah. True.
Yeah, that's a, well, you can say it's speaking against God, you can say it's attributing to someone else the words or the actions of God, or denying the actions or works or words of God. Okay, go ahead, Elaine.
Because God is witness of their inmost feelings and a true observer of their hearts and a hearer of their tongues.
Okay. You better watch out, you better not cry. Okay, go ahead.
Because the Spirit of the Lord has filled the world.
Ah, the Spirit of the Lord has filled the world. Are you beginning to get something sounding familiar?
Yeah.
The Spirit of the Lord fills the world.
Doesn't the Spirit fill John in Revelation?
Yes. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
And that which holds all things together knows what is said.
Notice in one translation it says embraces. Does yours say embraces?
All embracing.
It's all embracing. So what she reads says holding it together. Well, yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Therefore, those who utter unrighteous things will not escape notice, and justice, when it punishes, will not pass them by.
Okay. Notice very clearly this is an exhortation to wisdom. Wisdom is wise actions. And anything in opposition to God is foolishness and will be condemned.
It's a good thing we have confession then, because it seems
I'm sorry, what, Dan? I can't.
We have confession, you know, with reconciliation, because any day you can think of those.
The idea here is not simply having them come to mind, but thinking about them. In other words,
So it's something that's really deep in your heart that you do not believe in.
It's not just
know
just
God, God is dead.
What this thinking is not, as I say, not the fleeting, not that which comes to mind, but that which we keep in mind.
So it really calls us to change our actions, not just.
Exactly.
And if we don't,
consequences.
Consequences.
And attitudes.
Attitudes and, yeah, good.
Attitudes create actions.
I'm sorry?
Attitudes precede action.
Yeah, that's right. In fact, prepare for action.
Right.
Yeah.
And in my, in the way mine says it, in verse 4, it says, wisdom will not enter a shifty soul, nor make her home in a body that is mortgaged to sin.
So I love that.
They slap right in the face with the cross,
yeah,
you know?
Very good. Yeah.
Are you shifty, Fred?
I think
that's what it says. I'm just reading the words.
Yeah, some translators are better than others. Oh, this, no kidding. That is important to remember. No translation is equally good in every part. Remember St. Augustine's statement. If you don't read the original, get as many translations as you can and read those together, you get closest to the original. He did not read Hebrew or Greek, so he was speaking from his own experience. Go ahead,
Elaine. Before we go on.
Oh, sure.
Remind me again that the writing in this book, do they believe in life after death?
I want to let this tell you.
All right.
Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
For inquiry will be made into the counsels of the ungodly, and a report of their words will come to the Lord to convict them of their lawless deeds. Because a jealous ear hears all things, and the sound of grumbling does not go unheard.
Okay. Where do you get the idea that God is jealous?
He says it. I'm a jealous God.
Yeah. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. And notice all the way through the Old Testament, being unfaithful to God is equated with
adultery,
prostitution. Worship of other gods is prostitution. Remember what the word no is in Hebrew? That intimate experience of no and sexual intercourse, one word? Same word. Adam knew his wife and she conceived. So, you see, it was almost, kind of say, self-evident then, if you know another God, this is adultery or prostitution. Okay, Elaine?
Beware then of useless grumbling and keep your tongue from slander, because no secret word is without result, and a lying mouth destroys the soul.
Notice what you say in secret is known to God. Go ahead.
Do not invite death by the error of your life.
All right, now we're getting to Kevin's question. Do not invite death by erring ways on the error of your life. Okay, go ahead.
Or bring on destruction by the works of your hands. Because God did not make death.
Ah, how is it that God did not make death? How can you say that?
Because Adam did.
That's true. But how can you say that God did not make death?
Because death is seen as evil, and God does not make, it doesn't do.
And death is the absence of
life
or being. And God created life, created being. So death is the negation of that. Okay? Verse 13, start again.
Because God did not make death, and he does not delight in the death of the living. For he created all things so that they might exist. The generative forces of the world are wholesome, and there is no destructive poison in them. And the dominion of Hades is not on earth, for righteousness is immortal.
Okay, what is Hades?
Place of the dead.
Place of the dead. Okay. Notice, it says it's not a destructive drug, was it? What?
Poison.
Poison, not a destructive poison, a drug. You get this in two or three of the Shakespearean plays. And so that idea came on into Christianity and was taught, actively taught, for centuries and centuries, that there is no poison or deadly drug as such. What's it? What is it? What is that talking about? Rita, you're a nurse.
I'm sorry.
Lois, you're a nurse.
I was up in La La Land.
No, I'm busy thinking.
Pardon?
I'm busy thinking. I have to rewrite your words in my own brain to make sense.
I said, how is it that here and in tradition there is no poison?
Because God did create so good.
That's right. But there are, well, you would say poisons, wouldn't we?
Yeah. Well, in this imperfect world.
Well, but
we had a perfect world in Eden.
Okay. According to tradition, anything that can be used can be
misused.
So, what we call poison is the misuse of something God made. By the way, have you ever heard of somebody being given arsenic as a medication?
Yeah.
Okay. You see what I'm talking about? That's the idea. It's the misuse that is destructive, not the use. In other words, the use of it is helpful, bringing health and wholesomeness. So, you see, this is not our secular world. Am I making sense?
Yeah, poison is not a part.
Why do I say not our secular world?
Because we're all pursuing money and happiness.
Well, you can't say we all. You cannot generalize things. He's the devil's advocate.
Notice, this, God is all, I'm going to use a word from one of the translations, God is all-embracing, dear. You can't think about anything in this world without its connection with or separation from God. Do you see what I mean? If you think of a substance as poisonous, this writer would say, ah, you're misusing it. Because God does not make the destructive. He does not create death.
I think the phrase used in this translation is polar opposite of what God created.
Yeah, good. Notice this book is going to invite us to think in new ways.
Beyond our human way?
No, beyond our modern secular way.
Okay.
Okay.
I guess that's what I was thinking of when I was saying that.
Sure.
I don't know how we.
Years ago, did any of you remember Hermann Ellinghausen? The Ellinghausens were here. And Hermann was a good friend, and he often would come out with just whatever. And so he says, I'm just an old brainwashed cradle Catholic. And the statement he had made, I said, Herman, in this instance, you're just a brainwashed, secular, modern man. And this is, notice what is, we'd say, it's obvious, it's natural to recognize a poison. Natural is what we're accustomed to.
But poisons are very insidious.
Of course they are.
It's not always easy to recognize a poison. Take your example of arsenic. arsenic has a very purposeful medicinal use. So you don't recognize it as a poison. And it's that buildup of use that becomes mortal, causes death.
Yeah. I've never seen the awesome fine poison ivy out in the woods, but I've always done it.
I guess I'll put it like this. I'm going to keep it general and stay with arsenic.
Well, and going back to Dan's statement that I can only speak for myself, I have a bent toward sinfulness. That's part of my nature. That is part of my fallen nature. But as wisdom points out, it's being aware of that and trying to say, holy crap, God, I screwed up again. And that's what reconciling myself with God is all about, is not to seek perfection, because only God is perfect, but to be able to recognize in myself those things that I become callous to, those things that I build up the poison tendencies toward, that becomes death-causing for me. Elaine giggled when she read about grumbling. I'm an easy grumbler. Have our one little thing that is poisonous when used in excess. Food, drink, making fun of other people, grumbling, whatever.
I will say a couple of things in this regard. I think I may have mentioned this at one point. An evangelical was present next to an amen king when one of the priests and I was sitting at a table having some wine and conversation. And she could see in the window, she knew what we were doing. And she came to the door and asked if I knew where the next door neighbor was. Well, she came on in then. She didn't wait to be invited. And priest left pretty soon. He could see that this was not going to be where we had an intruder. As soon as he left, she says, is that wine you're drinking? I said, yes. Why do you drink wine? I said, I will respond to this if you will respond to your question, if you'll respond to mine. She says, okay. Now, this lady was more than a little bit overweight. And so I said, why do you eat sweets? She says, because I enjoy them. I said, that's my response. She said, but sweets are not destructive. I said, they aren't. She said, well, not in the same way. By the way.
Not if it's chocolate.
So notice that, an example of use and abuse, right? Okay, I would add also, it is appropriate to seek to be perfect.
Yeah.
In the sense of seek to be like Jesus. Notice I didn't say you're going to reach it. It's appropriate. The danger of that is, I don't chew, and I don't smoke, and I don't chew, and I don't go with the girls who do. That kind of self-righteousness, be careful of. That's the danger.
But I follow Benedict, who says, I do not ask you to seek perfection. I ask you to seek persistence.
And I will have to say, I like his statement.
I do too.
Okay.
Doesn't Jesus say, be perfect as your Father is perfect?
Yes. And God says, be holy, for I am holy. So that's what I'm referring to. Yes. We've got about 15 minutes, so I'd like to go on, and this is going to be responding to Kevin, I believe.
Life as the ungodly see it, but the ungodly, by their words and deeds, summoned death.
Notice, they summoned invited. Go ahead.
Considering him a friend, they pined away and made a covenant with him.
They made a covenant with death. Do you know that comes from Isaiah? That comes from the 20th chapter of Isaiah. Making a covenant with death. Go ahead.
Because they are fit to belong to his company. For they reasoned unsoundly, saying to themselves, short and sorrowful is our life, and there is no remedy when a life comes to its end, and no one has been known to return from Hades.
Does that sound familiar?
Yeah.
Isn't that what we just read in Ecclesiastes?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
For we were born by mere chance.
Okay. That's straight out of Ecclesiastes. We're born by mere chance. Go ahead.
And hereafter we shall be as though we have never been, for the breath in our nostrils is smoke.
Okay, notice, vanity of vanities, all this vanity, smoke, breath. Okay, go ahead.
And reason is a spark kindled by the beating of our hearts.
It's just a spark, that's all it is. Okay, go ahead.
When it is extinguished, the body will turn to ashes, and the spirit will dissolve like empty air.
Okay, notice, when you die, you're dead.
I need a jump start.
I love this too. Now go ahead.
It's depressing. Mm-hmm. Our name will be forgotten in time, and no one will remember our works. Our life will pass away like the traces of a cloud, and be scattered like mist that is chased by the rays of the sun and overcome by its heat. For our allotted time is the passing of a shadow, and there is no return from our death because it is sealed up and no one turns back.
Okay, now who is saying these things?
King Solomon.
Pardon?
King Solomon.
Oh. No, no, who is saying?
Oh, the evil person who was invited down.
Yes, the wicked, evil person. This is the view of the wicked or evil person. Do you see what this writer is doing with Ecclesiastes? This, if you will, this Pharisee is doing with Sadduceic thought. Keep reading.
Come, therefore, let us enjoy the good things that exist and make use of the creation to the full as in youth.
Did we not read this in Ecclesiastes? Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Let us take our fill of costly wine and perfumes and let no flower of spring pass by. Let us crown ourselves with rosebuds before they wither.
Ah, notice. A crown of roses, that's the goddess Spring. I mean, he's picking up Greek and Hebrew thought, and it's amazing what this writer does. And by the way, this is an author of the whole thing. This is a unified, coherent work. It's not like some of the other books. Go ahead.
Let none of us fail to share in our revelry. Everywhere, let us leave signs of enjoyment, because this is our portion, and this is our lot.
Notice, that's all we have. Enjoyment. Eat, drink, and be merry. That's what the wicked say, remember? Go ahead.
Let us oppress the righteous poor man. Let us not spare the widow, or regard the gray hairs of the aged. But let our might be our law of right.
Ah, let might be right. Wow. Gosh,
that sounds like modern day secularism.
I know. And by the way, again, Shakespeare picks up this material and uses it in the mouth of a villain. Keep reading.
For what is weak proves itself to be useless.
Anything weak, it's useless. Sound familiar?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Let us lie and wait for the righteous man, because he is inconvenient to us and opposes our actions. He reproaches us for sins against the law and accuses us of sins against our training. He professes to have knowledge of God and calls himself a child of the Lord.
Ah, interesting. Keep reading.
He became to us a reproof of our thoughts. The very sight of him is a burden to us, because his manner of life is unlike that of others, and his ways are strange. We are considered by him as something base, and he avoids our ways as unclean. He calls the last end of the righteous happy, and boasts that God is his father. Let us see if his words are true, and let us test what will happen at the end of his life. For if the righteous man is God's child, he will help him and will deliver him from the hand of his adversaries. Let us test him with insult and torture, so that we may find out how gentle he is and make trial of his forbearance. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for according to what he says, he will be protected. Error of the wicked.
Okay. Notice, who does that sound like?
The news media.
Sound like Jesus, doesn't it? But notice, this was written before the time of Jesus. You see why it's seen as prefiguration? As a type of Jesus who was to come? Notice, this is, it's saying, said you say, thought. Think the way the Sadducees think, this is evil, wicked. Now can you see why the Pharisees and Sadducees were absolute enemies of each other?
And yet they had the same.
You see what the Pharisees were saying about the Sadducees? And notice, they came together in opposition to Jesus. What is it that makes strange bedfellows?
Good attract you, or you don't attract everyone.
Yeah, okay. Now, does this surprise you, what you're reading?
No.
Had you read this before?
I've read it. Yeah.
This is, do you see why the church has used this through the ages as indeed wisdom?
It's getting down to what human nature really is.
It's dealing with us where we live. Mm-hmm. And notice, the church doesn't call it the wisdom of Solomon, as some do. The church calls it the book of wisdom. Okay, keep reading, all right?
Thus they reasoned, but they were led astray, for their wickedness blinded them, and they did not know the secret purposes of God, nor hoped for the wages of holiness, nor discerned the prize for blameless souls. For God created us for incorruption and made us in the image of his own eternity.
Notice, God created us immortal or imperishable. He made us in his own image. This certainly following Genesis in this regard. Go ahead.
But through the devil's envy, death entered the world.
Ah, through the devil's envy.
Is that the first time that they're saying Satan is the devil then, or?
He doesn't call him Satan.
Well, I mean, but when you translate it back, I guess, to Genesis, which you just said, you know, how it's called Genesis. The serpent was the one that's.
But the serpent in Genesis is a creature God made. And so it's laid in tradition, and you're getting something of the difference in the tradition. Later tradition that attributes calls the serpent Satan. Remember, Satan means adversary. And the serpent in Genesis was indeed an adversary, but not the adversary. but he's a type of the one who is to be revealed, if you will. Okay, go ahead, Elaine.
And those who belong to his company experience it.
Reread the entire verse 24, please.
But through the devil's envy, death entered the world, and those who belong to his company experience it. The destiny of the righteous. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God.
Notice, in the hand of God. Go ahead.
And no torment will ever touch them.
No torment will ever touch the souls of the just or the righteous. Keep reading.
In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster. But their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace.
They are at peace. Has this responded to your question?
Put it in black and white terms. This writer believes in life after death.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Keep reading.
For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality.
Immortality.
Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace, he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. In the time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubble. They will govern nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect, the destiny of the ungodly. But the ungodly will be punished as their reasoning deserves. Those who disregarded the righteous and rebelled against the Lord. For those who despise wisdom and instruction are miserable. Their hope is vain, their labors are unprofitable, and their works are useless. Their wives are foolish and their children evil. Their offspring are accursed.
Okay. Clearly opposing the foolish and the wicked, the righteous. And their destiny is very different. The book responds to you.
Yes.
Very well. That's the reason I said, let's let him respond. And okay, we'll pick up with chapter 3, verse 13 next time. And by all means, I love the kind of thing you were doing today, asking a lot of questions.
Are you going to make the outline like you've been with other books? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Oh, do you? I had an outline given out on this. And what wrote, I think this is so clear that the reason I gave you that material in Revelation because it's hard to follow. But I find the writing here very easy to read.
Well, certainly moves.
I mean, when did we ever go through this much in so short a time?
You broke the marriage.
But I think because of the nature of this material, I think you got it, and anything you forget, you can go back too easily.
I just want to get my money's worth.
Sorry, you never do. By the way, has anybody heard anything more about Dell than the email that Jim sent out that Mary passed along?
Of course, she doesn't want this.
Correct. We were talking just before. Dell is very private. And so you remember how long it took her to tell us that her daughter had cancer and asked us to pray for her. She's, you know, that's Dell. And so I don't know what the surgery was about. And if If she wants to tell us, that's fine. If she doesn't, that's fine. And so why does she not want this or this? There's, the doctors often say you shouldn't have visitors from people who've had surgery. The Holy Spirit in there. Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, we pray, lifting up Dale to you, praying that she may be healed, that she may also have a calm mind and clear sense of your faithfulness to her. We pray that you will be with all those sick, all those who are alone, those who are afraid, those who are in need in every way. We pray that, Father, we may recognize that we have been given to in order to share. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to read and think on this book, on the Book of Wisdom. And help us, we pray that it may give us new insight into how we should live and think and how we should treat other people. Bless us now and keep us faithful to you, we pray, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.